whoever's up there, I'm warning you to leave now. It's your last chance. Oh. Wait a minute. Oh. It's you again. I should have figured. I guess this is gonna be a thing now, huh? Well, I guess I won't be needing this. Or this. Or this. Or this. Or these. Or this. Or these. This, 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 this. This, 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 or this. Oh. Kit Kat. You wanna split? Okay, sure. So what brings you here tonight? Again. Nothing, really. You sure? You know, I feel like breaking it this way. It would just go against the universe itself, but I think I'll play it safe. Bon appetit. Just got something to drink. So, as I was saying, what brings you here? Is everything all right? You seem kind of down a little bit, and something bothering you? Well, you think about it, I was just, getting ready to make a video. Yeah, that's it. I'm gonna make a peanut butter and banana sandwich. You want one? No? Okay. Oh, alright. Give me a second. tonight is a Peter Pan kind of night. You know, it's cold. There's a crescent moon out. The night sky is full of a million stars. There's a strange stillness in the air. Yeah, I think it's a Skippy night. I mean, Peter Pan. Skippy, I forgot. Peter Pan, peanut butter, peanutty. And I got some more of that bimbo bread. Something on your mind, I'm gonna get a butter knife. I mean, it looks like, you know, you got something on your mind. I don't know about you, but I'm pretty good at reading people, you know? Not that I like to. It's my brain, you know? Do you ever think about that? What is the I? You know, who are we, really? You know, Freud and Jung, Carl Jung, to a degree, about the id, the ego, superego, all that. And scientists say, or I'm assuming it's a fact. Where's the twist out of it? Oh, there we go. There are like 14, I don't know, billion neurons or synapses, all interconnected, and within seconds they take the information in, you know, through our senses. They process memory, thought. I mean, we have a catalog up here. It's like a supercomputer, organic supercomputer. So it makes me think, you know, you think all throughout your life that this you, I, like as if this one thing, like, you know, this is who I am, you know, but there's all these microscopic synapses and neurons, and so is there one captain of the ship, or are we just a passenger? Are all these millions of neurons, are they the captains of the ship? You know? It makes you think, like, are we really in control of everything we say and do? Or is it the multitude of electrochemical impulses firing off like that, and we think we're in control, right? Things I think about. So, what brings you here? You can tell Uncle Rifty, Uncle E, Brother E, Paul, whatever you want to call me. Just don't call me late for breakfast or dinner or lunch. yourself lately? Come down a little bit? I can take it. I can relate. Maybe a little depressed. Yeah. I've been there. What's that? Something else? What is it? Look, you can tell me. The wife and kid. They're not listening. He's asleep and she's all doing whatever, so it's cool. Just me and you. Alright? What is it? You've been having some suicidal thoughts? Yeah. I've been there too. I knew someone was bothering you. You know, it's good to talk. You need to talk to somebody. You can't. You know, I tell our son that all the time. And he's, you know, when they say the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, let me tell you, it doesn't. You know, this whole journey of mine, very surreal. I never expected to be a father. I never expected to make it this far in life. You know, mid-40s, slowly creeping up to 50, you know. I got more gray hairs and a silver back. But when you have, your whole life changes when you have a kid. And when they say that the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, it's the truth. Our son is just like me when it comes to, you know, creativity, but also thinking. I just asked him the other day, do you find yourself thinking a lot? And he said, yeah. Well, he nodded. And I try to get deep, but, you know, he's slowly creeping towards 10 years old. And, you know, he doesn't like to have those deep conversations. He just kind of shuts me down. I mean, it's all good. But, you know, he's young. You know, he doesn't want to, you know, talk like that. And the last thing I want to do is force him to grow up or have serious conversations that you don't want to have. I know the boundaries, you know. But once in a while, I'll try to sneak in something like that. And you know, my whole point is, we are our parents, and our parents are our parents, and all that. I know it's all passed down. It's not just physical genetics. And this is nothing new. I mean, this is just stuff that I've gathered. Whatever. Now, it's mental. Our psychological traits are passed down, without a doubt. So, the way you feel, the way you think and all that, your parents are the same. You know, you should open up and have that discussion with them, or if you are a parent yourself, you know, try to have that discussion, but not when they're too young. You don't want to kind of get too serious on them. You know, you want them to be a kid. You don't want to expose them to all those adult kind of thoughts and stuff, you know. There are some things that you just don't talk about, you know. But I know all about, let me grab a banana here. I know all about depression, suicidal thoughts. And I'm not, you know, you're showing up here, so you're stuck with having to listen to me. I mean, you can walk away anytime, that's cool. I'm still gonna eat my PB and banana sandwich. But, well, if you're here and gonna hang out, well, unfortunately, you're gonna have to put up with me a little bit. Yeah, you can ask me. Yeah. Some tingles? You would like, if I could. What the sounds cool. You're not putting me out. And that's what everybody wants me for, is for the tingles, you know? I'm just trying to, you know, I'm just trying to be creative, do some experimental stuff, and you know. No, it's okay. I'm okay. It's feeling a little overcooked right now. Okay, the moment's passed. Anyway, I got my goodies over there from the other night, from the last video I did. Where I wasn't speaking and everybody thought I was like tired or all this. Well, I mean, it was 10 o'clock at night, but I wasn't exhausted. If I was, I wouldn't do a video. This is my resting face. And I'm sorry. Well, I'm not really, but I'm sorry if that comes across like I'm sad or something. I'm not. So, I know we like to judge. We are judgmental creatures. That's what we do. It's part of our being a human being. We judge our surroundings all the time. We try to make... That's just what we do. It's inherent. It's very difficult to overcome. I'll get my backpack and we'll share some tingles together. Is that cool? Especially since you're not feeling like yourself, so just slice it in half, and then slice it in half again. Just make my little sandwich here. You know, yeah, I'll tell you in a minute. Let me just get my sandwich. Slice that in half. Alright, there we go. I like to put the peanut butter on both sides of the bread so it kind of sticks and all that. So it's not just all banana on one side and all peanut butter on the other. When you bite into it, it's like the perfect bite. No problem admitting that I am a walking contradiction juxtaposed against itself. I don't know what that means, but I like the sound of it. I don't think we should be drinking milk because we're not calves. I mean, really, the milk that comes from a cow's teats is for calves, you know? I don't want to go over this again, but I'm just going to say we're all born into this system, you know, and it's very difficult to change habits and anyway, I've learned to accept and not care and not give a shit about a lot of things, because I'm going to be dead soon. So, what is it, you know, whatever, that's just... We all justify things. We do. You know, you justify your lifestyle, I justify mine. Well, I don't really justify it too much anymore. Anyway, want some milk, tingle, milk, bottle cap? There you go. Regular bottle cap, but I just finished my water. I think there are other ways that we can get our calcium besides from a cow. think one of the big problems is that in here in the United States, to raise a family, almost it takes two people to work. And a mother, when she raises a child, unless they can afford, she can afford to stay home. Most mothers only stay home for like 6 weeks and, you know, and nurse their child. And I think mothers should be nursing their children for a long time. I don't know, it's the whole first year, first 2 years. And I think that is very important. That is the, you know, mother's milk is the, you know, the building blocks, or, you know, I don't know how to say it. I'm trying to say, like, very important. And I think, I don't know. Anyway, enough about all that. I'll cut this in half in case you want half, okay? I'll leave the half here. Let me get the backpack. I'll be right back. Paper cups. I got all the same stuff that I got on the, that, you know, like I said, that no speaking casual ASMR video. These are from Aurora, 1966. He's so underappreciated. Over 1,000 videos, he's been doing ASMR before. I mean, for a long time. I mean, he's been doing it for at least 5 years. I've been doing it for 4. But I think he's been doing it 5 or 6. And he deserves so many more subscribers. But I know why he doesn't have them. One. Part of it's probably because of the language barrier. 2, he doesn't do a lot of the personal attention, ear-to-ear stuff, and that's cool. That's his style. But he just, as a, just for the amount of content, and you know, that's the funny thing. And his video, you know, and the videos aren't pretty. You know, it's not, I shouldn't say that. I don't mean it like that. Let's be honest. We like shiny, flashy things, you know? You know, we love the pretty butterflies, like the fast, all the flashy graphics, you know, that's all that stuff, you know? So, not that you need that stuff, you know, but anyway. So, you know, he deserves, yeah, I just think he deserves so much more. Especially when he's a family guy. You know, I kind of relate a little bit to that. You know, he's got a, you know, so. Anyway. So, your suicidal thoughts and depression. Well, suicidal thoughts and depression. Well, let's start with the suicidal thoughts. First off, as I've said in the past, if you really are having serious thoughts, please call a professional, call a hotline, okay? Let's make sure that's understood in case right now you are really having them. But I'm gonna go on the premise that, you know, you may have them, but they're not that strong. Well, anyway, I don't know when I started having suicidal thoughts, but I've had them through my 30s, late 20s. I don't think as a teen, I mean, even through the stuff that I went through as a kid. I don't want to repeat myself. I'm not looking for sympathy. I'm not playing a pity party. But I was picked on. I was called names. You know, and I'm just a typical white kid. And where I grew up, skinny, bad haircut, and I wore glasses. So I was an easy target. Name called, you know, I was in high school. I had someone spit, was it high school? I think it was, early high school. It was outside of school, it was somewhere else. I was hanging with our friends and these other older kids came and one of them hocked up a real nasty loogie, I guess. And spit it right, I'll never forget. We were standing right outside the elementary school, Catholic school that I went to. And we were just goofing around in the parking lot or whatever. I think they were on their bikes. I think we had our bikes. Anyway, and he spit right here. I'll never forget. And it smelled, it was humiliating. I don't even remember who that dude was. I kind of vaguely remember that I might have known him. He might have gone to public school. I don't know. Anyway. But I
don't want to get into the whole thing. I had my jaw fractured. I don't want to get into a whole about me.
Even with all that I went through, I don't know if I had suicidal thoughts then. But the depression and the sadness that started, I still had some friends. I had one really good friend from 7th grade up all the way through high school, so I think that helped a lot. But even with that, it wasn't like my whole life was just a dark, pressing thing. I still had plenty of happy times. So it was a mix, you know? It was a lot of times when I would take especially in my 20s, I would drop a Sudafed pill. No, I wouldn't mix it with anything to make meth. I know there's some kind of prescription drugs people would buy to mix with whatever. I never did that. I would just use the pill because those allergy pills or whatever, they would make me real drowsy. And so I would take one like in the afternoon or whatever and just sleep away all through the night and sleep away, you know, like 10, 12 hours, whatever. But even with those dark times, I still had good memories, you know? So it was up and down. My whole life has been a roller coaster. So the depression kind of started in high school, you know? And then the suicidal thoughts started in the 20s, late 20s, and just with frustrated with the job, frustrated with knowing that I can be creative doing something. I just wasn't happy with my life. You know, um,
I say? I never did anything heinous. So. And I say that because I'll be thinking, why would I have suicidal thoughts? Just be, you know, from the unhappiness, and not in the happiness because I didn't have money. I mean, I had, you know, a little bit of financial, some financial pressures that played a little bit of a key. Not too bad though, you know, but it was more just emotional turmoil. And it wasn't like, you know, man, I don't know what to do with myself. You know, I know I can draw and all this, but I'm gonna, you know, kill myself. It wasn't that. It wasn't like because I was bored, or it was just very, it started from all the crap that I went through in high school, and a lot of anger, and that stuff just took forever to get over. And you know, I had to work through it every day, fight through. Every day was a battle with my, in my own mind. And suicidal thoughts, whenever I get stressed, I, you know, fuck it. Maybe I should just kill myself. What's the point? And I started looking into nihilism and looking into all these other things, and met my wife, and God bless her. She's a saint, really. And we found each other. It was very unique situation how we found each other. We were both looking at it was a short window opportunity how we met. And then we had a son. I mean, everything just started happening like that, unexpected. And I don't know if I never met her and we didn't have her son, if I would still be here, you know. It wasn't that bad. I don't know if I would ever go through with it, but I got close. I don't think I could ever, you know, put a rope around my neck or anything like that. But I did buy a gun once. I was fired from a job. I don't know, maybe it was part of my fault. I don't know if they were downsizing to the place I worked with. They went under pretty much. So, I went and was very, like, it wasn't so much that I really, really wanted to kill myself, but I did have those strong feelings. It was also, part of it was like, can I actually do this? Go and buy a gun? Part of it was that experience. I went to the gun shop, the local gun shop. I was talking to the guy. I bullshitted and said, I'm looking for a gun for protection. Signed whatever you have to sign, you know, to purchase a gun. Didn't buy any bullets. Was too nervous to buy bullets, I think. That vaguely recall that. came home, put the gun in the closet. I just was like, what am I doing? My wife came home, which was my girlfriend at the time. And I showed her. Yeah, and she didn't, like, freak out or anything, but she started to know me well enough, and my demeanor wasn't that bad. And then at some point I joked and said, you know, what am I going to do, beat myself with to death? Because I didn't have any bullets. So I brought the gun back, like, the next day, I think. And, you know, he was, like, kind of not too shocked, but I was like, my girlfriend, you know, I told a white lie and had to sell it back for half the price or something. But I'm stubborn. And I think that helps. I don't know if the people that do commit suicide, they aren't stubborn. That there's something that isn't stopping them. And, my heart goes out, and I hate to do this kind of sobering video, because I know, I'm sure you and everybody else out there comes here to for some entertainment, so to speak, you know, to get away from all this talk. I think sometimes we need to have these discussions, you know, because people have these thoughts. Doesn't mean they're crazy. Plenty of parents, workers, everyday people, teachers, lawyers, doctors, plenty of people deal with this stuff, but we don't talk about it for various obvious reasons, because some people, there's still stigma that if you have these kind of things and you're crazy or need meds or whatever. Anyway, and then, you know, just continue to get a job, continue to try to find myself creatively. It was a lot of frustration, losing my patience. And then, you know, we had our son, and then I learned and realized I gotta get my shit together. Having our son, I wasn't a complete mess. I've never needed medical, maybe I could have. But I was too stubborn. I thought I can manage myself. And I have. There was one time when I went to see a psychiatrist. I saw two, actually. I saw one. Just because I had a lot of anger and a lot of just stuff from, you know, what I went through in high school and all that. And still, it was like a big earthquake. And then there are still some tremors, you know. And I told this one psychologist all this stuff. And now she said, so what do you want me to do for you? I'm like, are you kidding me? Isn't that your job to tell me, you know? And this laughter is the best medicine. Even when I was a kid, always goofing. I love to joke about the things that that you shouldn't joke about. And I don't mean making fun of, you know, serious things, you know, that some comedians have joked about. There's a line that I won't cross, but I think there's a lot that we can joke about. We shouldn't take ourselves too seriously. A lot of people are too sensitive, take themselves too seriously, don't joke around. I love to make fun. That's what we do. That's just, you know, it's harmless. You joke around with your buddies, you joke around with your family, whatever. You make fun of each other. You don't do it all the time, but you know, that's what you do. And some people are just, you know, but anyway, laughter. That's comedy's huge part of my life, but we had our son, and I had to get my shit together. Like I said, not because I was like some raving lunatic or anything like that, but still a little turmoil and anxiety. And I just willed myself to and constantly aware of myself reflected, very self-aware of everything I did, constantly improving, and I still do that. I still make mistakes. I try not to, but I still do. I do the best that I can do, and you know, this is what works for me. I can only share you my experiences and to tell you so you know that you're not alone. You know, I've had suicidal, I've had the depression. Maybe do you need to be diagnosed clinically depressed to say you're depressed? I don't think so. You know, and all I can tell you is that two things, at least. Number one, they're just suicidal thoughts. It's depression. They're just thoughts. It's just a moment. Now, I'm not gonna say I know your situation. I'm not gonna sit here and talk. I'm not gonna tell someone, a homeless person, or someone with cancer, that fine smile at all, you know. I'm stumbling here because, to a degree, they should try to enjoy their life as much as possible despite their situation, but at the same time, you can't really expect a homeless person or a person with cancer to enjoy life, you know. So I'm treading very carefully here, but I'm gonna, like I said, I don't know you that well. So I'm saying the two things, right? Suicidal thoughts are just thoughts. Once you, even if you have an internal conversation in your mind and recognize that it's, I'm not gonna kill myself, you know? If you gotta do that, whatever you gotta do, you know, I've done that, you know? I'm not gonna kill myself. I'm not gonna let this world win. I don't know. You know, and as much as it's tough, to work through that stuff. That's, you know, that's what I've done. Everybody's different. I can only tell you what works for me. And let me switch that up. You want some different tingles?
Yeah.
How about something? How about some cardboard? Suicidal thoughts are just thoughts. Depression, like I said, I'm not gonna tell a homeless person that it's gonna get better. But if you're not homeless and if you're not living in squalor, like not the Philippines, but there is a country where like 80% or something, it's a very high number of the people live in poverty. If you have a place to live and you have food in your cabinets and your refrigerator and all this, and despite you might have some financial problems, but for the most part, you have nothing to complain about. Just, you know, just remember that suicidal thoughts are just thoughts. Once you can recognize that, that helps a lot. It's just your fight or flight response. Your body, your brain wants to escape the pressures of, you know, that's why a lot of people, that's why there's that dissociation. The brain just can only take, it's very delicate, can only take so much, and it has a defense mechanism. You know, that Corn song, A Freak on a Leash, maybe. You know, sometimes I flirt with suicide, it helps to escape the pain, flirt with suicide. Some say that's, I don't know, I forget anyway. I flirted with suicide plenty of times. And the other thing, you know, so it's just thoughts. And what was the other thing I wanted to say? 10 minutes ago, there's two things I wanted to say, and I can only remember one of them. Did you want the other half? So, like I said, this isn't, you know, I know you didn't come here to hear me talk, and I'm not trying to talk to hear myself talk, or one, complain about my problems. I'm trying to share with you personal stuff, because I don't really give a fuck anymore. I'm going to die at some point. I'm, you know, in my mid-40s, and I'm going to die between now and, what, 55, 60, you know? I've outlived some folks already. Great folks, Kurt Cobain, Bill Hicks, you know, a lot of these folks died young, you know, and here I am, who am I, you know, but, you know, you get older, and you give a fuck less and less, what was I saying? So I'm just trying to tell you so that we can relate to each other, so that you know you're not alone, you know, just Google. I mean, not on Google, but go on YouTube and search suicidal thoughts or search something like that, and you'll find other people. I'm not the only one. You'll find plenty of other people, not necessarily in the ASMR community. But you'll find other folks out there vlogging, everyday folks that maybe they don't have like a couple subscribers because they're not really running a channel. They're just using YouTube to as a vehicle to express themselves, which is all. Which is how I started. What the heck? There's two things I wanted to say that helps. Recognizing the suicidal thoughts are just thoughts, and depression is just, you know, get better. Is it laughter? No, man, I don't think it was laughter. Fuck. It's late. It's like 11 o'clock or 11:30 at night, Friday night. Listen. Well, I'm going to talk about something else that maybe will jog my memory, you know? Kind of, you know how that works? It's weird how the brain works. You're stuck on something, you go do something else, and all of a sudden, boom. Why is that? You know, just access, go down whatever aisle it is, section A to G, whatever shelf, 839.2, like you're in a library, and pull that book out. Why do I have to go down another aisle and read something else for my brain to go, you know, oh, that's the, you know what I'm saying? No, you don't know what I'm saying. My mouth can't keep up with my brain very often. I can't keep up. My brain. I'm not saying I have like this amazingly, but my brain goes a lot, which is why I've never had a problem sleeping, because my brain is so active. By the time 11 o'clock at night rolls around, I'm dead. I'm tired. So, I have plenty of videos planned. I have an experimental video, which I haven't done in a while, and I love doing those kind of videos. Candyman, the Repairman, Professor Clemens. I'm actually going to do a Professor Clemens video before everything started. I've been thinking about kind of really do the story aspect of things much better than I have. The peculiar plastic pouch, predicament, the curious case of the couch companion, in other words video, the Dungeon and Dragons part 2 with the character creation video, the ASMR lounge where I play the flute and I do some ASMR, Margaret, another Satan video, death, grandpa. I mean, I'm gonna, just takes time. I go with the flow here, and I still can't remember the second thing that helps. Oh yeah, time. See, I knew that was gonna happen. Time. Seriously, time heals all wounds, is what they say. It does, both physically and both in the physical sense and the mental sense, or non-physical, or whatever you want to say. I'm in my mid-40s, and I'm not trying to brag, but I don't have suicidal thoughts. I'm in a very, my whole life has been surreal, and I'm not trying to be dramatic. I mean, there's a part of me that is a storyteller, not a liar, but a storyteller. And I sometimes have a penchant or flair to be dramatic, but I'm not. What was I saying? They say time. Well, time, you know, you have a wound, you put a band-aid on it, whatever. And time does heal your physical wounds. And it happens to your mental wounds as well, or however you want to say that. And here I am, in my mid-40s, and all that stuff that I really went through seems so distant now. It almost seems like a whole, like it didn't even happen. It's very weird and strange. Not like I'm a different person, and I'm not trying to over-dramatize or anything like that. I'm telling you, it just seems weird that what I went through in high school is just, you know, it's just how long it's been. And the suicidal thoughts, I don't have those anymore. I've reached a point now where if I do have a stress, or I can think about losing my job without, you know, if I get fired, it's not, you know what, I kill myself, that quick, that little thought. I don't have that. It's like, you know, I'll get another job. Because you know why? Because I've gotten jobs all throughout my life. Worst case scenario, I'll figure something out. You know? What was I gonna say? And I used to have suicidal thoughts when we when our son was young, because not that I not wanted to be a father anymore, but I used to have these thoughts where I brought a kid into this world, into this fucked up world. I used to think about that. And I had a conversation with someone about that recently. This world is pretty messed up, but there are a lot of good people in the world. And so, I think one of the things that helped with the suicidal thoughts for me is having a son. Now being the love that I have, that I would never, ever leave him or do anything. Making all these weird gestures, I think, to abandon him. My goal now as a father is to try to stay, avoid death for as long as possible. I know my death is coming, whatever my preordained time is. You know, am I going to live till I'm 60, 70, 80, who knows, right? Things happen. Now my job is, aside from this, being here for you and enjoying what I do, mutually beneficial relationship that you and I have here, you know, this isn't just about me. There's a little bit of enjoyment. Well, almost every medium is pretty much, but this ASMR thing is something special here. I don't want to, again, make it out to be this grandiose thing, but something a little different, a little special here. And, you know, but my job now as a father is to try to give that kid a safe and happy home, which he has. He's doing well in school. I hear from other parents. You know what? This is becoming about me, isn't it? But it's supposed to be related about you and your suicidal thoughts and depression. Not so much about me. So why am I talking about me being a father and all that? I guess just because it's helped. That's all I'm trying to get at. That's what's helped. So, yeah, how I overcame a lot of the suicidal thoughts and depressions, because now I know that I'm not going to abandon him. So all that time, having a son, and just fighting through the days, you just get stronger, and eventually you just distance yourself from all that. You learn to, you know, some people need medication. Okay, that's fine. You know, I'm stubborn and not to need, and I've got reached a point where I'm at peace. And it's just weird. I'm not here to brag. Like, hey, look at me, man. I'm not longer depressed. I don't have suicide. That's not, I don't play those games. I'm just trying to tell you. Okay, maybe, you know, depression still rears its ugly head. I lose my patience. But when I lose my patience, I don't, you know, of course I have a son, so I'm not apt to throw a lamp across the room like I may have done in my 20s. I never punched a hole in the wall, I don't think. But, something else I wanted to say, but, so, what I can tell you is, remember, suicidal thoughts are thoughts. And be patient. Time heals all wounds, but be patient with yourself. And that's the two things. Well, the three pieces of advice. I would say laugh a lot. Laugh at yourself. Laugh at the human race. The things that we do. How silly sometimes they are. And you gotta be able to laugh at yourself. You gotta be able to, that's it. Being self-deprecating, you know, I've already laughed at myself before anybody else can. So, you know, preemptive strike. Just try to fill your life with humor. You know, I love comedies, you know. And a lot of comedians, Bill Hicks, Bill Burr, George Carlin, Doug Stanhope. Yeah, they're raunchy, but they tell it like it is. That's real. That is real. And there aren't good comedians who are clean, and that's real too. But I just like the edgy stuff, because that's the stuff we don't hear, because we're still very, as a species, we're still very focused on what not to say. We're control freaks, man. We're crazy. We are. We're a bunch of primates, and we wear clothes, and you know, all these rules. I mean, for the first 20 years of your life, if not more, you're constantly told what to do. You know, what to wear, how to act, how not to act, do this, don't do this, turn on red. Don't turn on red. Sometimes those signs don't even make sense. Don't turn on red, but there's nobody coming. Or you're at a red light in the middle of the night and there's nobody there. Why can't I go through the red light? There's no one around, you know? A lot of these signs should have, like, proceed with caution. You know, the red lights at night should go yellow. Blink red all the time, or blink yellow, whatever it is. Letting you know that proceed with caution, but anyway. You know, we are, we're crazy, man. Anyway. So, you know, I'm sorry, I'm just trying to give you examples of things that, that's worked for me. And if you don't ever get married or have someone or have kids or anything like that, then you got to be happy with yourself. You can't, my wife and our son are not here to make me happy. You know, I don't use them. I don't do things. I don't manipulate them so that they can make me happy and give me love. I'm already have found self-love. You know, I love myself. You know, sounds weird, but no, I mean, I am who I am, you know, and if you're going to be happy in life by yourself or with someone, you have to be happy with yourself, and then it's going to spread, you know. And if I talk here in extremes, or I make a lot of assumptions, or it sounds like I have all the answers, this is just how I am, right? This is just my own take. I know I explain myself a lot. I usually don't ever explain myself because I really don't give a shit too much. But I know how sometimes I can talk like I know everything, and I'm, you know, not. Just my own experience works for me, and what I think can help others. But, you know, what was I saying? Yeah, you have to be happy with yourself. You gotta accept who you are. This is it. This is your vessel. This is your vehicle. This is your shell. You know, this is what we're stuck with. So, accept it. You know? I have constant tinnitus. There's a constant ringing, like that rush. Not a high pitch. It's kind of lower than a high pitch, but it's there. I can't. I'm deaf. I'm not sure if you say deaf or I have hearing loss. So it's very difficult to hear in noisy environments. And I did have some suicidal thoughts. When I had, I think I did. I just remember having some depressing moments with that. But now, I find it funny. Here I am doing all this, you know, these ASMR videos where sound is so important. And I've always loved sound all throughout my life. Just love. Sound, everything, the sound of the wind, the birds, the car on the gravel, the horse going down a cobblestone, whatever, you know, you know, and I had to come to accept it, you know, and I'm probably going to go deaf, lose both when I get older, I may, you know, if that one's gone now, this one's going to get worse as I get older, I've just, you know, it's just, life is just like a puzzle, and we're just constantly, it's like a, constantly learning and trying to put pieces together, and it's just on a, so, I hope that helps a little bit. Try to do something constructive. Keep it busy. And don't let yourself dwell on thoughts. And, you know, make sure you go out into life. Quit your job. Do something drastic like that. As long as you're not going to put your whole family on the street, or you're going to go on the street. But if you can afford to make a drastic change, a city, do it. Because you don't know where you do something. It seems like you put yourself out there into the universe. I'm not trying to get like that new age. I know nothing wrong with new age, but I want to, I'm not talking like that. I'm just saying, when you put yourself out, something things happen, sometimes bad, but you find yourself in unexpected life-changing events sometime. Just don't ever stop exploring and don't lose your curiosity and your sense of wonder and keep that inner child. Let them out and play. Let them play in that sandbox. Let others play in the sandbox with you, you know? You know, just don't give up hope. Keep hope. And just live every day. Live for the moment. Live for now. Live for each moment. You know, right now, you're still, if you've had suicidal, here we are. All the moments, however many videos you've watched or however long, you know, you've been dealing with these suicidal thoughts, you're still here, right? So that's more time that's passing. More, and you're distancing yourself. You know, and that's, you just need to keep fighting. And life is just always going to be up and down. It is. And we don't know when our time is to come. You just got to be able to accept that and be able to laugh about it, because that's all we can do. You know, here today, gone tomorrow. What are you going to do about it? And that's another thing. You can't worry about what you can't control. No point worrying about, you know, you got a place to eat, you got food. Cool. You know? I know life can be more complicated than that when it comes to things like finances, student loans, car payments, bills, losing a job and you got kids. Man, I know. You know, it's easy for me to stand here with my own personal experience and go on about, you know, how life is okay for me now. I'm not going to say life is good, but I'm at peace. You know, I'm not here to say, I'm not here to, believe me when I say, I'm not here to say life is good, man. No. But I know that anything could happen to us, to me, and leave my wife and son, you know, or her, or both of us. I mean, things happen, man. And things happen to people every day. Tragedies. That's why, you know, life is short. It really is. As much as it is long, it really is short in the big picture. And so, just, I'm rooting for you. You know, I want you to wake up every day and just keep fighting. And I'm not the only one. Other ASMR creators want the same thing for you. Other viewers want the same thing for you. Other people out there in the world, the librarian, the guy working at the gas station, you know, whatever, plenty of people in different situations care and want the best for all of us. So, especially for you, especially for those that struggle. So, I hope that helped. You know, besides, you don't know what you're going to offer to the world. You might end up being a parent if you're not. You might end up doing, you know, even the smallest, even just holding up, doing something that makes someone smile, or letting someone in your commute, that someone trying to yield into your lane. You know, there's so many little things that we can do. And, well, you know, we'll always have our human element and we'll always make mistakes and lose patience or whatever. I know I will. No, I'm not going to speak for you, but I think my whole life has been mistake prone. But I do my best. I have the best intentions. But I also have to think about what's healthy for me. You know, it's... but, so... I hope that has helped. I got a whole mess to clean here. I got, you know, I was down in the basement, you know, just, just getting ready for a video. That's all. Oh, not the basement, down the sub. basement. Which, maybe, you know what? If you're here, this is going to become a thing now. Maybe I'll take you down to the sub-basement. Family doesn't even know about it. It's pretty cool down there. I think you might like it. What do you say? Maybe next time. Okay. All right. Well, I get back to work. And, you know, why don't, you know, you can feel free to hang out here, whatever. But, it was good seeing you. Thank you for, you know, for stopping by. You know, I hope you're doing all right, and, I hope things turn around for you sooner than later. All right. I gotta catch some Z's. Take care of yourself, okay? And you feel free to stop by anytime. And you already know how to get in. So, apparently, I don't have any say in the matter, but let's just try to do this every week, you know, once a month, once every 2 months, or something like that, because I have other videos to do, you know, and as much as I love to, you know, have the late night sessions, you know, I still got other folks out there I got to deliver to, you know. I got folks in the basement. I mean, I have folks in the basement. I'm just kidding. Sub-basement. No, I'm just kidding. There's nobody in the sub-basement. There's not other people that have come in my home like you and end up in my sub-basement. No, nothing like that. So, alright. So, till next time, take care of yourself. And, wish you all my best, all right? All right. Stay well, be safe, and live life to its fullest, moment to moment, all right? Till next time, tingle on.